Ladies and gentlemen, it is my simple, rather task this afternoon to guide you through this simple and short program. Today we launch a program that has been in the making for about a year now, since the Honourable Madam Chancellor spoke to us hugely about this. It's taken a while to get done, but we're deeply, deeply happy today that it is actually going to begin. And so I'd like to invite to give the opening remarks for today's event, the 10th Vice-Chancellor and Principal of the University of Guyana, Professor Ivelaw. Please welcome him with a round of applause.
Let's give the Vice Chancellor a better round of applause. Come on. Good afternoon. Madam Chancellor, Madam Chief Justice, members of the Diplomatic Corps, Professor Michael Scott, Deputy Vice Chancellor of Academic Engagement, ladies and gentlemen, all. I want to invite a certain member of the audience to stand when I call his name. And the person whose name I'm going to call is Justice Brassington Reynolds. Please stand, sir. Now, Justice Reynolds has a $5,000 bill in his right pocket. He may not know he has the $5,000 bill. And he will give that $5,000 bill to anyone in the audience who gives the correct answer. Please be seated, Justice.
Thank you.
Who will give the correct answer to a question that the Vice Chancellor will pose. That question is, name the foremost 19th, 20th, 20th, 21st century psychoanalyst of the world. Name the foremost 19th, 20th, 21st century psychoanalyst of our world. Going once, going twice. Going. I need to see one person because Justice only has one $5,000. Yes, Lord? It could be done by the Chief Justice and Madam Chancellor. Well, in order to save Justice Reynolds' $5,000 bill, I'm going to acknowledge what I heard in front. And that the foremost, universally accepted foremost psychologist who developed the field of psychoanalysis, is a gentleman called Sigmund Shlomo Freud, better known as Sigmund Freud. And I want to read one powerful sentence from Sigmund Shlomo Freud, which I think is a useful epigraph for the 1.5 minutes of Guyanese minutes remarks I will offer. What Freud said that I'd like to commend to you is the following. We are what we are because we have been what we have been. And what is needed for solving the problems of human life and motives is not moral estimates, but more knowledge. Let me repeat. We are what we are because we have been what we have been. And what is needed for solving the problems of human life and motives is not moral estimates, but more knowledge. The program that we are launching this afternoon, the programs that we at the university, in partnership with entities, some of which are here, is precisely to do what Sigmund Shlomo Freud recommended. Not to pontificate, not to do moral estimates, but to ground our engagement in knowledge, in evidence-based knowledge. And so I'm delighted that part of what our university is able to enjoy communities such as the one we hear about and hear from this afternoon, is to take a leaf out of the recommendation of Sigmund Freud and enable us to intervene in societies in a variety of different domains using the basis of that intervention, knowledge. The harsh reality is, though, that sometimes, although we have areas of knowledge intervening appropriately in resolving issues, in solving problems, the special skills that are there in those domains need to be complemented by other skills, other areas of knowledge acquisition. And so we have the opportunity to put knowledge on knowledge, people who have knowledge already as judges and counselors, people who already have knowledge as law enforcement practitioners. We cannot afford the luxury of moral motives, of interposing our values. We have an obligation to use additional knowledge, additional skills, to be able to solve the problems of human life and motives, to use the word of Sigmund Freud. And so I'm delighted that the University of Guyana is able to pursue this program, a program that is an 8-module, specially designed course for persons who work in the legal and the legal support systems. It's a program intended to support the services offered in the prosecutorial and the management of sexual offenses domains. It's a program that has some specific objectives, and I'll tell you what those objectives are. To provide support to the judiciary and the allied services in providing professional and evidence-based best practice, grounded in relation to the areas of concern sexual offenses courts in Guyana. Understandably, ladies and gentlemen, a program like this, and a reference was made to that fact by Professor Mohamed, a program like this has seen the enjoining of very many partners. And I'd like you to help me acknowledge those partners at the end of my listing of those partners. Those partners involve UNICEF. Partners involve the Faculty of Health Sciences. Partners involve the judiciary of our nation. Partners involve the task force on psychology. And I'll tell you who comprises that task force. The task force is led by Professor Paloma, Mohamed. It involves Deputy Vice Chancellor Michael Scott, our registrar Dr. Nigel Graves-Zambi, Mrs. Padmini Passad Roberts, Dr. Don Stewart, Ms. Carol Lord, Ms. Juanita Cameron, our UNICEF and CAMPA representatives, Dr. Khadija Khan in particular, please help me applaud and congratulate all those partners for having made this program possible. We recognize one of our core responsibilities as a university is to treat with problems in our society. Problems that have both a contemporary manifestation and or problems that we anticipate, given the trajectory of our national development, will be calling into question our preparedness to deal with them. And so, going back to 2017, at the university, in response to existing and anticipated needs, we engage in the production, the preparation of a variety of programs in the area of psychology. And I want to let you know, ladies and gentlemen, we graduated the first batch of students in our general psychology diploma, 23. Give them all a round of applause. Hopefully, we'll be able to make some more impact on the contributions of the intended roles we anticipated to have. We currently have this year a new batch of 27 students in that general psychology diploma program. And we're working through enabling us to launch in May of this year the master's in clinical psychology to be followed later on in the bachelor's in general psychology. Understandably, ladies and gentlemen, while in the context of what Sigmund Freud recommended, we are here in the business of enabling the knowledge to be acquired and shared, we cannot do this without financial and moral support. And so I want to end on the note of thanks to all the existing and future agencies that will join with us in enabling us to make further contributions in this domain and in many other domains that are of pressing national need. So let me end where I began by commending to you the words of wisdom by Sigmund Shlomo Freud. We are what we are because we have been what we have been. And what is needed for solving the problems of human life and motives is not moral estimates, but more knowledge. This is a program that is predicated on eschewing moral estimates and advancing more knowledge. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice Chancellor. The programs that the Vice Chancellor would have listed in psychology have all been supported in large part by two main partners. One is the CANPA, which is the Caribbean Students Network of Psychological Associations. And I'd like to ask Dr. Kujikan to take a bow, because she has been working with us for 2 years. She's a clinical neuropsychologist and heads the Department of Neuropsychology at UWI in Trinidad. And she's been working with us and will be, in fact, one of the teachers on this program. And of course, UNICEF is the other one. And so it gives us great pleasure this afternoon to invite the resident rep of UNICEF, Ms. Sylvie, Fouet, to give her remarks on behalf of the funding agency. Actually, I'm not a funding agency, I'm a support agency. I'm always told that we are not a funding agency. So, Sylvie.
Allow me, all protocol have been observed. I just want also to thank and acknowledge the presence. It's okay, yes. Also acknowledge the presence of UN resident coordinator, Mikiko Tanaka, and also partners that have been working with us on this. But allow me to thank the university in general and the judiciary to partner on together in its part of implementing the Sexual Offences Act, which was passed in 2017. And ahead of International Women's Day, allow me to thank really three special ladies. So Paloma, who is the head of the psychological program, Chief Justice and Chancellor of Justice, that are also two strong supporters in the judiciary, but also adding a gentleman, the dean of the university department, which is part of the, we call it Health Faculty of Health Services, if you allow me, Dean Cummings. But above all, it's really, as you said, Professor Griffiths, it's no one's going to do it alone, so it's really a partner. But for me, it's really also a little ahead in Guyana that you bring the law with science. Because forensic trainings and capacity is really bringing science and a little more. Have you seen a lot of cases that have been brought to the court? And in particular, with you saw maybe a couple of days ago, there were also conversation of how Guyana can build capacity on DNA testing. Because so far we still have, you know, we do the sampling and we do the forensic, but so far Guyana has to send the samplings and the tests outside. So I think it's also building, you know, linking, like I said, the law and science. So it's really some milestone and breakthrough in Guyana. Today also the launch gives us the opportunity, the interest and the healing, as you will say, Professor Paloma, and results for children. In particular, the conversation is around how court personnel and all the judiciary members can engage differently or have the capacity to engage with children being in particular abused of sexual violence. And we know it's not an easy task, and it's very usually was led to maybe child protection specialists or health specialists, but it's really good that we see also the court and the personnel to embark and embrace those conversations, because it is always a challenging way of interacting with children who have been abused, in particular survival of sexual offences. The trainings, as you explained, Professor, I don't want to say the objective you clearly outlined, but maybe just to say it will be a series of cohorts, and at least UNICEF will commit to support the next three cohorts of court and court support personnel to complete this training series, and I understand it's a module of 8 components. A little more on why we're doing violence against children, just to let you know that in Guyana, it's really an alarming rate, and since the beginning of 2019, we already have 400 cases being reported. And last year, it's about 1,000, I believe. Sometimes it went up to 3,000 cases. But it's for me, you know, it's an increasing, what we call an emerging silent situation, and more needs to be done, we know, in the prevention, but also in the community part. So that's part of the conversation. The partnership between judiciary, academia, and UNICEF allows also to join forces on different entry points. Today it's also a chance to celebrate, so celebrate results and celebrate possibility to increase those capacity, like I said, by bridging law and science. As you may know, it's a new elaborate few steps. It's at the, with the University of Guyana and in general with the judiciary, a lot of important milestones have been taken since 2017, since the law on sexual offences law. The Sexual Offences Court in 2017, the Children's Court in 2018, and as you mentioned, there's also a couple of programs with the University of Guyana. In 2019 and maybe 2020, there is plan to bring those services to scale, in particular with the leadership of the judiciary. We're looking at expanding the court system outside Georgetown, and plans for Berbice and Essequibo, and therefore increasing access to services for children in challenging or having abuse in being victims of sexual offences. Within university, the training series complements existing program on psychosocial, and you also refer to clinical psychology that we start next year. For us, this, as we say, these services are not only necessary in some cases, maybe sometimes beyond social works, and it's a new avenue when we enter the mental health. And I think building those capacity will help heal, find solution in Guyana. And through the PACE program, we're also joining forces to invite the private sector and young people and championing in generally leading those changes. I understand the bar and the medical council also will hopefully champion those changes. So I don't want to, because I see all our partners in the assistance, so I don't want to, you know, I'm sure you're convinced, but I can continue to invite you to join the championing those in leading this change. Today's action also will inspire innovation in judiciary, the bar and the academy at the medical council I mentioned will also change the way we respond and we document violence. Plus, we begin to develop the forensic psychology, which is the theme of that series of training, but it's also within the sphere of sexual violence, violence, justice for children, and the family court setting as well. We hope this initiative will lead to greater appetite on building local evidence to inform and the practice of the law for children. As we know, there is no such power fact-finding, evidence-based documentation before and in front of the court to get the case and unity executed. Lawyers may be the top consumers of forensic psychology, and we look forward to closing the gap from sentence to treatment, because it's not just the sentence that is also what services are offered after, in particular for the healing part. And this is particular also working with Ministry of Public Health, is also, as you may know, open Department of Mental Health. We look forward to this continuous focus on children issues, and also let you know that there is also new, not new element, but maybe more increased element regarding drugs in school, regarding also mental health and need for counseling, regarding bullying and regarding lack some time of counseling or mediation in school. So again, it's part of a journey, but this is really bringing the law and the science and at the same time entering this difficult world of psychology and mental health. So again, congratulations for the Judiciary, Chancellor and Chief Justice, University of Guyana, Professor Griffith, Mohamed Dean Cummings, and for us, every child protection, for every child partnership, and for every child healing. Thank you so much. Thank you very much, Sylvie. I'd also like to make a special mention, although this is unusual, of Ms. Pat Giddens of UNICEF, who has been working tirelessly with our programs over the last 2.5 years as the project manager for UNICEF Center. She does not take no for an answer, and so she pushes us to do things that we would not normally attempt. And this is one of them. I'd like to acknowledge also Madam Chief Justice. I was in a hurry to start, right? I'm kind of correct. And also Deputy British High Commissioner, Mr. Davis. There are a lot of distinguished people in the audience. I'm not wearing my glasses. And so please, Michelle from UNICEF, Justice Barnes, I'm seeing Justice Curtis. Well, Justice Reynolds has been acknowledged already. I've seen walk in Cara Lord from our task force. She's somewhere in the back there, who's also been working here. As I walk around, I'll recognize the other people and remember. So when I started talking about how long this program took to put together, I didn't tell you why. And part of the reason why is that in the university, in most universities, those at the back and those at the front, the real scientists, so the medical doctors, and the ones who are not considered real scientists, the psychologists, tend not to speak a lot. And so to get the medical doctors to work with us on this project took a very special human being who is open to a lot of challenges and a lot of argument as to why forensic psychology is not medicine. And we really, really want to acknowledge and thank the Dean of the Faculty of Health Sciences, Dr. Emanuel Cummings, for eventually sitting down and getting his colleagues to work with us on what is, I think, a wonderful pilot project, and it's going to be very exciting for those people who are able to take it. And for those of us who are able to deliver it. And so I'd like to ask you to give a rousing round of applause and to welcome the Dean of the Faculty of Health Sciences, Dr. Cummings.
Thank you very much, Professor Mohamed. Chair. Chancellor, Professor Griffith, UNICEF representative, Ms. Sylvie, Fouet, Madam Chancellor, Madam Chief Justice, I also recognize the DPP, Mrs. Hack, other distinguished judges, Justice Barnes, I think, I've known him for quite a long time, and our own Deputy Vice Chancellor, Dr. Ken, who's been a consultant in all the things we do in psychology, teaching other distinguished persons who are here. I guess this is a room full of distinguished people, also all distinguished ones. A pleasant good afternoon. Let me first thank Professor Mohamed for approaching us in the Faculty of Health Sciences as we collaborate in this project in forensic psychology, and I did indicate to her that once you use the word forensic, you talk about forensic medicine. Forensic goes with medicine, forensic science. And being someone who's been teaching molecular medicine for a number of years, I was able to convince her that this project of itself must have a strong component in forensic medicine. And so that the two, forensic psychology and forensic medicine, can certainly play a significant role in increasing the capacity of the judiciary in solving crimes and cases. Now, I just want to give a background to everyone. I think every speaker has given a justification as to why we should have this program. I just want to add to that, since I think whatever decisions we make should be based on evidence. The UN in 2002 reported that 1/3 of women worldwide have been a victim of sexual violence. When we look at worldwide figures, the countries that are more guilty of sexual crimes are Finland and Denmark, which has reported more than 50% of women who have been victims of sexual crimes. Generally, in Europe, 1 out of 3 women have suffered some form of physical or sexual assault. 5% of those assaults have been raped. Going around the world, in Zimbabwe, it is reported that 60 women are raped on a daily basis. As you get closer to home, in the Americas, in Canada, there are over 500,000 sexual assaults committed on women annually. The UNDP has reported that Latin America and the Caribbean is the most violent region in the world for women. It means, in other words, it means it's the most unsafe place for women to be in Latin America and the Caribbean because of these type of crimes. Highlighting Central America and Mexico, it is of the view that the rate of sexual violence against women outside a relationship, we in Latin American Caribbean, we have the highest in the world. 3 of the 10 countries with the highest rates of rape of women and girls are countries in the English-speaking Caribbean. 3 of the 10 countries, namely, Guyana is ranked number 2. Among number 1, I think it's very unfortunate. Number 1 is Honduras, number 2 is Guyana, followed by Jamaica, Trinidad, and Tobago. It is a view that this plague of violence against women do possess a threat to human rights, public health, and public safety. And so in light of all of this, we are delighted to partner with peace, to partner with the judiciary in making this program a success. Now, one of the aspects of resolving or solving cases of this nature is DNA profiling, which constitutes a significant part of the program which we plan to roll out by the end of the week. According to data collected around the world, DNA profiling has been mostly used in sexual offenses. The evidence that can be arrived from DNA profiling can make or break the outcome of a case. And I'll give you an example, one that I always share with my students every year. It allows for the comparison or comparing the profile of the perpetrator against the list of other suspects. The likelihood of holding the perpetrator accountable. The likelihood of preventing future crime, since The perpetrator DNA is then added to the database. Studies have indicated that there's an increase in guilty pleas and reduction in retrial or after trials with the use of DNA profiling in solving these cases. There seems to be quite a lot of success, particularly in strange type crime. That's when the victim is not knowledgeable about the perpetrator, where we can use DNA profiling to pin the person to the crime. This program, which we will roll out by the end of the week, will be delivered by a number of experts in the field, the best we have around. Some of them already been highlighted, Dr. Khadija Kandu, clinical psychologist, Dr. Mohamed herself, who is a social psychologist. We'll have a forensic medicine specialist in the name of Dr. Singh, which most of you have seen in course on a daily basis, or pathologist. We have an OBGYN specialist, Dr. Roseanne, and myself, who's been a lecturer in molecular medicine for over 20 years. So we, as a team, will ensure that whatever you learn will significantly make an impact in resolving cases in the judiciary. So the applied focus of this course will provide an excellent foundation for continuing education for the judiciary in various forms of forensic science, including forensic psychology and medical science, in an effort to strengthen the justice system by building the capacity for the use and interpretation of more credible evidence. These skills will impart more from leading experts about current research and debates in forensic psychology, DNA profiling, and other areas to directly affect people in all points in the legal system. Certainly, we will all develop a critical awareness of topics at the forefront of criminology and forensic psychology and forensic pathology, with specific reference to sexual crimes, as well as the context and theories that influence practice in these areas. So it is our wish that at the end of this cohort and all the other cohorts, we can see a significant improvement in how cases are dealt with in the justice system. Let me just share with you how DNA profiling has been used across the world. And this is a story which one of my favorite programs is Investigation Discovery. And I do hope that most of you will be watching that as well as. And sometimes I wonder if our prosecutors and our police officers are not really watching that program. And it's a story about a man who was convicted because of his cat. Sounds really weird that he got convicted because of his cat. And so a woman was found murdered. She was in his apartment. When investigators came in, she was there, she was raped and she was murdered. And of course, they looked at the body, they examined the body for all evidence, and they saw hair on the body that wasn't her hair, because in turn, of course, and so DNA profiling was used to determine that hair came from a cat. It was a human hair. That was the only evidence that was found on the victim. And so they had to hire a special geneticist to determine the genome, where exactly, or what species did the hair came from. And it was determined it was cat's hair. So what happened next was that one of the suspects had a cat. And so what did they arrested the cat. The cat was arrested and taken into custody. And after the cat was taken into custody, the next step was to match the hair on the cat to that found in the victim. And after that was done, then they arrested him. Because what happened was that he was always playing with his cat, the hair from him was left in the victim. So these are kind of evidence, stories which we can learn from, and in which we can improve in the justice system. And then that is what we attempt to do, using evidence from sexual crimes to advise the jury what are some of the samples that can be used for DNA profiling. As we enhance our forensic laboratory, so we can certainly improve in convictions and make a safe place. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cummings. I spotted a few more people in the audience. Justice Gio Hussard, and Justice Madam Hack, and Justice McKinnon in the back. Others I'm going to get to. I just want to say two things before we continue to introduce the key speaker for this afternoon. And that is, I don't want people who are going to take this course to think that we have been watching videos only. And we're going to be teaching from that. It's going to be quite intense. Hopefully not as much reading as we have had to do to prepare for this. We try to save you from that. But certainly, it is quite a fascinating course. It goes across from anatomy all the way up to, as Dr. Cummings is saying, molecular biology, but it also spans things like how to write cases, how to interview people, what kind of language, the kinds of sexual disorders that we might find, the theories, the cutting edge issues, and of course about, you know, what is happening now with technology, how sex crimes and technology are interacting. And what is happening with the law across the world and things like that. So it's going to be, I think, a ride. And not from TV. So without further ado, it gives me great pleasure to invite the lady who really is the person who's been pushing for this to come to the mic and speak to us this afternoon. A lady who is, I'm sure, carrying a great burden at this time on her shoulders for many reasons, but she's there smiling, looking beautiful as ever, Madam Chancellor. Please welcome.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Registrar, Deputy Registrar, Ms. Patkittens from UNICEF, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, members of the press, good evening to you all. This evening we are pleased to collaborate with the Faculty of Health Sciences of the University of Guyana and UNICEF Guyana for the launch of the Forensic Psychology and Sexual Defenses Program. You may ask why they need for training in this field, or why, what does this have to do with the law, or with the courts, or with cases on the board? But permit me to tell you in a few brief sentences why this initiative is useful. For just over 1 year now, we have established the Sexual Offences Court in Guyana. And you heard from Ms. Fouet that plans are afoot to take the services of this court to Burmese. And even as we speak, that operation is ongoing and we should be ready within another 2 months or so for Burmese. And then from Burmese to Essequibo, we will be having a Sexual Offences Court throughout the counties, the three counties of Guyana. The impact of sexual offenses in Guyana is nothing new. You heard from Dr. Cummings' statistics worldwide, so I will not go into that. But we research, literature has shown that the impact of sexual abuse has far-reaching emotional, psychological, and physical effects on victims. So women, children, persons with disabilities, and even vulnerable and marginalized groups and other victims of sexual offenses have special needs as they engage the court system seeking justice. In that regard, insensitive treatment of victims, especially within the criminal justice system, can result in secondary trauma to the victims. Again, the complexities of working with victims of sexual violence require specialized training and intervention on the part of all involved in this process. Victims not only require support services, but they also need to be treated with fairness and respect for their dignity and their privacy. Even the offenders too cannot be left out in this regard. Therefore, to ensure prompt, adequate, and effective court response to the needs of justice for both offender and victim, an intensive approach is needed. That, ladies and gentlemen, should tell you why we're here. But permit me to go further to say that persons engaged in working in this field, they also need debriefing programs to deal with the vicarious trauma, as we call it. So from working with victims and offenders in sexual offenses, personnel engaged in this activity, in this work, are also liable to secondary trauma or vicarious trauma. And so sustainable skills and capacities are needed in this regard. Hence, the launch of this program. It was Nelson Mandela who said that education is the most powerful weapon with which you can use to change the world. And we intend to change or even revolutionize the landscape of the sexual offenses approach in Guyana. The efficacy of the court will ultimately depend then on its personnel. And the equipment and the court do not exist in a vacuum. The human resources complement, the court personnel, the social workers, probation officers, even the NGOs providing support services, the prosecutors, the police officials, the magistrates, the judges, we all are part and parcel of the training program and part and parcel of the body that has to respond and to provide justice. Since its establishment, the personnel of the Sexual Offenses Corps and social workers and investigators have benefited from training in this regard. But this program is another step in the right direction as it is more intensive and specialized in the field of forensic psychology, molecular biology, and technology. We intend to improve our adjudication of sexual offenses cases, reduce or eliminate secondary trauma of victims, and to adopt a coordinated approach with all stakeholders, as well as enhance our awareness of the evidence-based knowledge in this direction. Therefore, for us to spend 6 half days or 20 hours delving into the psyche of the victims and offenders and understanding the psychology and the medical issues involved in sexual offense cases, for us to appreciate that there may not be physical injuries in some cases, but they are psychological scars, for us to understand the emotional reaction, which can vary, for us to understand that alcohol consumption and drugs can significantly affect perpetrators' behavior, for us to understand the external environment of the abuser and social and cultural norms and even myths, and even be more aware of the cultural milieu and the best practices in relation to sexual violence, having to spend 20 hours or so would be worth the while. We, therefore, think that this is a worthwhile investment, is an investment in knowledge, in skills enhancement, in judicial, or continuing, I should say, judicial education and training. It gives us time for critical reflection and thought as we engage in realities to promote improved competencies. So we're looking forward to marrying our skills and our knowledge with the social sciences, to marry our skills with forensic psychologists and the doctors and the technologists, and the experts will be rubbing shoulders with each other, and we will be the richer for having participated in the program. So having that kind of information that this program offers will greatly assist us in the handling of cases and the dispensation of justice. The profession with which we are engaged is a noble profession, and indeed it's a noble job to dispense justice and to provide access to justice, and to do so with the relevant tools, expertise, and training. So as we look forward to the engagement with the University of Guyana and the lecturers, Dr. Mohamed from right here at the University of Guyana, Dr. Khan, Ms. Chor, Mr. Scott, and Dr. Cummings, and maybe Professor Griffith at some point in time. Like Freud, we look forward to more knowledge. I read somewhere that silent gratitude is not enough or is not much use to anyone. And so, while appreciation can be silent, gratitude must stand up and speak up. We are grateful to UNICEF for partnering with us in this initiative. We're particularly grateful to Ms. Fouet and Ms. Gittins for the tireless hours they spent writing emails and trying to coordinate with the Chief Justice and I and members of the University of Guyana trying to get this program off and running. They both remind me of the song, the Soca, A Monarch, 2019, from Trinidad. Mr. Killer said, run with it. It's a song that generates energy, a song that shows cooperation and togetherness. And the energy that they brought to bear in getting this program or this initiative going has been tremendous. Thank you so very much, Ms. Gittins and Dr. Fouet. On behalf of the Chief Justice, the judges, magistrates, registrar, and deputy registrar, we say a heartfelt thank you to UNICEF, to University of Guyana, and all partners and all stakeholders for making this initiative possible. We are looking forward to this program, and we can assure you that the knowledge base or the skills gained from this training will definitely put into good use. So we thank you for coming on board with us, and we look forward to the commencement of this program in a short space of time, in a few days from now. Thank you so very much for the courtesy of this time.
Thank you very much, Madam Chancellor. Just to indicate that there, each one of the modules is being taught by a different person. So there's Dr. Rosa Hudson, as well as Dr. Quincy Jones, Dr. Nihal Singh as well, teaching. So it's quite, and there is a module on self-care that they insisted that we put in, and we have. So my task was to say thank you in the end, but I think Madam Chancellor has done that quite graciously and effectively. And so I am just going to say again, warm and special thank you to all of you for attending, for the courtesy of listening, to UNICEF, to the Pegasus Hotel. Okay. So, I just received an instruction which I have to follow. And the Vice Chancellor is indicating that he had not mentioned that one of the donors who has been working with us on the psychology development of the program and project of psychology in Guyana is Jane Sylvia Subraj Foundation, and they have actually given a beautiful building, $500,000 building, which will be opened on April the 12th on our campus. And so while this first cohort, which begins this weekend, is not going to be able to use that building, subsequent cohorts will be in a very space-specific facility that is designed for teaching psychology. That center will house the first training school or center or lab for counseling in the country. So we are going to be able to watch how people are trained and how they're counseling people and be able to support a lot more the support services in the country in a couple of years' time, and hopefully in a couple of months, but not 6 months, right? It takes a long time to create a concept, proper concept. So we want to acknowledge the gift of the Subraj family as well, as part of the mix. And so we come to the end of the program. Thank you so much for being here, for participating, for giving us the courtesy of your attention and your wonderful presence and smiles. Please get home safely, and we hope to continue our work with you. There are some light refreshments outside. Thank you all very much.